did this, I took something important, I remember.
Don't do it.
Was this all stuff you still have to sign?
Yeah, I still have to sign.
And then same with Kevin, right?
Correct.
And you and Kevin.
This is all gone that way.
I'm gonna put it over here for those two to sign.
What, youngster?
Oh, I got you.
Last time I had it over here.
You youngster?
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Monday, February 26th meeting of Litchfield Board of Selectmen. We've just come out of paperwork session, and we'd like everyone to rise and say the pledge of allegiance, please. Most of you are here. You good?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It's always good when you hear kids doing that.
Yes.
You can always pick out the kids. All right. So up first, we will do the approval and review of consent items. We have an AP manifest for February 20th, 2024, in the amount of $57,485.72. And for February 27th, 2024, in the amount of $2,066,852.84. Payroll manifest for February 22nd, 2024, in the amount of $56,904.67. And for February 29th, 2024, in the amount of $59,707.71. We have a veterans credit recertification. Are there any items people would like to discuss or remove or table for now?
There's something I thought there was.
I want to add something else to
that's
consent.
That's for the, yeah. That's after, yeah. So hearing none, we'll entertain a motion to accept.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second it.
We have a motion from Mr. Gannon and a second from Mr. Lynch. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 4-0-0. Oh yeah, also important to note, Mr. Weber is not here tonight. He is away with his family. I hope he's having fun in the sun. Now, requests for other items, other business.
Yes, I have two items. Item one, credit card approval form for the town credit card to Dan Jones, Chief of Police. Okay. The second item is 2025 reappointment to District 21, Forest Fire Warden to the following individuals: Deputy Wardens Craig Cartier, Ryan DeFranza, Ed Glancy, Paul Kelly, Brian Kimball, Jeff Newell, and Warden to be Doug Nickel.
Nothing's changed.
Yep. All right. Anybody have any questions or comments about that? Okay. Hearing none. We need to vote on that. We need to vote that into the agenda.
That's an appointment.
Yep. Okay. So we need a motion to add these items to the agenda, please.
I'll make a motion to add those two items to the agenda.
A motion from Ms. Queenan.
I'll second it.
And a second from Mr. Gannon. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 4-0-0. All right. Up next, good stuff. Promotions. We have two promotions. Slade C. Rasmussen and Brian D. Morgan to sergeant. With that, we'll turn it over to the chief, Dan Jones, and our town clerk, Terry Briand.
And I'll turn it over to our clerk.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Would you like me to? I have a letter if you'd like me to read it for him.
Sure.
Okay. You don't want to do the public speaking part?
Yeah, I don't have my letter with me.
Okay.
We'll do it. I don't blame you.
We'll do Mr. Morgan first. All right. Dear Chairman and Board members, effective February 26, 2024, Corporal Brian D. Morgan is eligible for a promotion to sergeant at the rate of $41.15 an hour. His new grade is in accordance with Article 14 salary schedule, effective July 1st, 2023, agreement between the Town of Litchfield and the Litchfield Police Department, AFSCME, July 1st, 2021 to June 30th, 2024. Would recommend that the board approve his new grade as Corporal Morgan has successfully passed the sergeant's exam and earned a position in competitive process. Known him for a while. I think he's a great officer. Yep. Oh, second one is Slade Rasmussen. Effective February 26, 2024, Master Patrol Officer Slade C. Rasmussen is eligible for a promotion to sergeant at the rate of $41.15 an hour. His new grade is in accordance with Article 14, salary schedule effective July 1st, 2023, agreement between the Town of Litchfield and Litchfield Police Department, AFSCME, July 1st, 2021 through June 30th, 2024. I would recommend that the board approve his new grade as MPO Rasmussen has successfully passed the sergeant's exam and earned the position in a competitive process.
Yep.
Yeah, and I'll turn it over to you. Congratulations to both of you guys.
There's one.
It's all good.
All right. Do you solemnly swear that you will faithfully and impartially discharge and perform the duties incumbent upon you as sergeant according to the best of your abilities, agreeable to the rules and regulations of the Constitution, the laws of the state of New Hampshire, and the ordinance of the state of New Hampshire, so help you God?
I do.
In the town of Litchfield.
I do.
Congratulations.
Now turn yourselves around, guys. There's been a lot of cameras in this corner over here.
Pennings? Yes.
Oh, another chain.
Congratulations, guys. It's awesome.
Welcome to Litchfield.
All right.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes?
If I can just say something now?
Absolutely.
We had three officers put in for the two sergeant's positions,
mm-hmm.
and we had three exceptional candidates. I could have literally closed my eyes and threw two darts, and whatever two names I hit, I would have won. I'm very fortunate to have inherited the people that I have inherited, and now I guess on some level I am responsible for the two that I promoted. so I'm very happy about that.
You're good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir. All right, up next we have two new officers who are actually returnees, if I understand this correctly. Just one?
Just one.
Oh, who? Jared McDonald and also Michael Richardson. Gentlemen, come forward.
Hey, those are cameras. Go on the other side over there and block everybody.
Okay.
Come on.
Have Terry turn around.
There we go.
Do you solemnly swear that you will faithfully and impartially discharge and perform all the duties incumbent upon you as a police officer, according to the best of your abilities, agreeable to the rules and regulations of the Constitution of the state of New Hampshire and the ordinances of the town of Litchfield, so help you God.
I do.
Congratulations, guys, and welcome.
Welcome.
Awesome. That's it for this, right? Okay. Is there anything else? Chief, do you have anything?
Actually, if I can just add, again, these are two experienced officers. I realize they both look like they're too young to be experienced. But we're very fortunate to have people with experience come in the door, which means we can basically give them a car and a zone and say, go to work. So,
yep.
Again, very honored to have both of them with the department.
Come shake our hands first.
Yeah, you gotta come up.
Welcome aboard. Thank you.
Oh yeah. This is the part we don't do.
Welcome aboard.
Welcome back.
Congratulations, Sergeant. Congratulations, Sergeant.
Welcome back.
I think you came on our side
one day. Oh, yeah, I know. Oh, I remember that day.
Good to see you, Harry.
God bless you.
Congrats. I'm gonna take it. Nice seeing you.
Yeah, nice. Congrats, nice job.
Yes.
Yep, coming around. Coming around.
Congrats.
Now go have cake.
No cake.
No cake?
Cupcakes.
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 I think we get a cupcake. You might see a little bit of this as me clapping it.
It's a home video, yep.
They were doing that when I pulled up and all the cars were out there. I was like, oh my gosh, what's happening?
Karen's like, oh, what trouble should start now?
The what?
The demo.
Which demo?
That's in the hallway.
I got a little nervous when I walked in.
That's in the hallway.
Oh, are they? Okay.
I'd like to see it gone, to be honest with you.
He was supposed to come too?
Yes.
All right.
Unless he was out in the hallway and just can't get in.
Gail.
Gail.
Yep.
Let's see.
Bob.
The first order of business is an interview.
Okay.
Jose Medina. And I don't see him.
I have approval of the minutes and then then planning board. Yep. Is Mr. Medina here?
Hi, Paul.
Oh, work.
Is he coming in?
New Hampshire program.
Huh.
Okay. All right. Very good. Up next, the approval of the minutes for February 12th, 2024. And as we discussed before, we're going to table them.
Yeah, can we table them?
Give us a chance to go over more. Okay, so that will be moved to our next meeting. Up next, planning board appointment for Mr. Medina. Is he here?
Yes.
Hi, come on forward, please. Good, how are you doing?
Pretty good, yourself.
Good. Hang on while we find you. Mr. Medina, recommendation. Everybody recommended you, right? Kim, you were on the planning board as our rep.
Yes.
What is
our take?
I'm having a hard time pulling the thing out.
Oh, I'll just read here. A motion was taken at the planning board. Michael Croteau and myself approved. The motion was made to recommend Mr. Medina for the planning board position to the Board of Selectmen. So he came in front of us. He understands site plans, HVAC. Okay. You're a business owner in town, right?
Yes.
42 employees or something pretty large. So we thought he would be a great asset to the planning board.
Okay. All right. Vote 4-2-0. Okay. Very good. Does anybody have any questions of Mr. Medina? Mm-hmm. Yep.
If I may, Chair,
sure.
I've had the pleasure of working with Mr. Medina on two issues that have arisen. Both Mr. Blackwell and I, as well as Ms. McKibben, have spoken with him and worked on through a couple of issues. I found him to be very respectful and professional, and I found that he kept a very open mind in the many details that we were trying to portray to him. So I think he would do the same on the planning board.
Okay. Kim?
No, I agree. And I like that he has experience in the trades, which if I was to do my career over again, I'd probably do that myself. But I think he brings that experience to the board.
Are you
which
in the
we
trades?
Don't have anybody on the board who knows that. So
yep.
That would be very helpful.
Which part of the trade?
HVAC.
Oh, hot air. You let it go with that. I used to be a building inspector
many
for
addicts.
A short period of time.
All right. Steve? No? Okay, hearing none, we'll entertain a motion to appoint Mr. Medina.
I'd like to make a motion to appoint Mr. Jose Medina to the planning board, Litchfield Planning Board.
Very good. We have a motion from Ms. Queenan.
I second it.
We have a second from Mr. Lynch. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries 4-0-0.
Tough, wasn't it?
Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Very good.
Mr. Medina, if you can stop by and see our town
Terry?
Clerk. Carrie Brienne.
If she's still here.
She's still here.
Before you attend the next planning board.
Okay, she'll be here for tomorrow?
She will. She's here from 8 to 4.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Have a good night.
Up next, we have the Corning Farms demo permit. Ms. Kleiner.
Yes, so I felt that we should bring this up. Both Mr. Blackwell and I have spoken to Mr. Morrow, and we believe that the board needs to weigh in on this item at this time. There seems to be some confusion as to the next steps that the board has chosen should take place. So Mr. Morrow is here this evening. As you remember, back in December, the board instructed me to reach out to Mr. Morrow and ask him to agree to delay the public hearing, as the Heritage Commission had not yet entered the premise. They had that inspection or walkthrough scheduled, but unfortunately the public hearing was scheduled prior to that. I'm not sure if there was someone on vacation or someone was returning or something to that effect. There is also the issue of an amended site plan that the planning board has taken up since, and they have spoken. Mr. Morrow has gone to the planning board since. So I think we're asking the board to give some clarification on what you would like next.
All right. Kim, being our rep to the planning board.
I'm trying to recall. I'm in a lot of committees. Planning board, you did come in and gave us a conceptual of what you wanted to do. Maybe remove the house and put a, not take the barn, but put some kind of a community building in that area. So we don't have an official site plan yet, right? We had your conceptual.
Yeah,
I'm just trying to remember.
Sneak up here for a second.
Come on up.
Reggie Moreau.
How are you?
Good, yourself?
Good.
So, yes, what we were looking at doing is amending the site plan.
Mm-hmm.
Part of that process is what's the cart and what's the horse, trying to figure out what has to go first. So the amendment of the site plan would be to take the home, which is currently a duplex, replace that with a duplex in an alternate location on the site. And then we were looking at opportunities to put a community building, not where the house is, but more in line with the wider area of that open corral space. Where the house is now, of course, it's going to be, when they do the 10-year plan, you're going to find that the front of that house, we gave them an easement to state right up to the foundation. That's what they were looking for. So when they do their 10-year improvements on that, that's going to become a problem for the house. It's already been hit a few times, and it's probably going to get hit a bunch more times if it stays in its current locations. So we decided that with all of the things going on with that site, with the home itself, we made the determination it would be better for us to not try to do anything with the home and to actually look at amending the site plan to accommodate the duplex somewhere else. It was approved for 66 units.
Mm-hmm.
And so we just want to just continue with that number of units.
From where I've, and I haven't been part of this process, but from where I've stood from the beginning, the intent was to save the house, which it's a landmark in town. It's an old property. It's been, centuries old, and I understand the bones are still good in it. So, it seems to me that a lot of approvals were given based on the fact that you would leave the house, tear down the barn, but leave the house. So it kind of is, and I'm not speaking for myself, but there is a lot of talk in town that that was just show and tell to get the house taken down.
I think that was, the intention was there to see what we could do with the house. We always mentioned in the process that's not a definite, that we were going to have to get into the home. We would have to look at it, and we'd have to look at all the other things that go along with that.
Mm-hmm.
After looking at all of that, we've determined that that's not going to be the case. We're going to end up having to demolish the home. If they want it, If anybody wants it and they want to move it, they're welcome to it. Anybody wants any part of it, they're welcome to that. We just have nothing that we can do with it. And as far as the bones go, I'm not sure who's giving you that information, but there's a lot of issues with that home.
We have members of the Heritage here. Would they like to maybe chime in on this?
Well, first, we should continue with Mr. Morrow before we bring in Heritage. So I'm confused about the whole process, too. It seems like we've entered a stalemate where this gentleman's been trying to get something done since December. We're rounding March in 3 or 4 days. and it seems like there's just a lot of confusion on the boards on what is the next step. The Heritage is now hanging their hat on that they can't move forward and have a hearing until there is an amended site plan. So that would put it back into the planning board. You're saying there is a verbal amended site plan, but not an official amended site plan that shows the house being removed.
Yes, because the question that I had is treating everybody fairly. And I think the Board of Selectmen said that, go to the planning board, right, to treat everybody the same. I understand there's two questions being here. Should the Heritage Commission permit go forward is one question. Mm-hmm. But I have another question about purposely putting yourself in non-compliance. So I don't know what happens when you do that. I don't know if you get a write-up or a fine or cease and desist or why are we here. So I think the Board of Selectmen, if I recall, said go to the planning board because the site plan was signed by him, DOT was signed, so now you're getting out of compliance if you take the house down. That would be like you have somebody having a site plan for 20 buildings and puts 19 up, or they have a site plan for 19 and put 20 up. I mean,
well, I could see a site plan for 20 and you only put 19.
No,
that's not really a deviation.
This is a contract you made with the town, and all the engineers approved it, and it went through a lot of work. So,
and now he wishes to amend it.
But amend it, he hasn't amended
okay,
it. That's
so that should be the next step then, right? I'm still learning all this. So
that's what I want to find out.
The Heritage Commission cannot do their function because they're waiting for an amended site plan. The Planning Board is also waiting for an amended site plan. The amended site plan is going to include the removal of the old home, the addition of the community space, and I think you're going to have like the mailboxes in there, small barn, I believe you said. And then it's also going to have account for the two units that you're pulling out of the old home and building new. So I would think just the addition of the two new units going in, even though the count is not changing, the format, the location is going to change, as well as the community room, community service room. So I think that would automatically, would that not kick off a new site plan requirement? And then that would go right back to the planning board and then come back down through?
I'm not sure if it's brand new, but I think it has to go get vetted again. There's a lot of engineers that look at this, and I don't know about DOT, but we'll have to look.
I don't think removal of a house is going to deviate DOT's plan. I don't believe that removal of a house is going to alter the plans that much.
Nobody's adding more.
The plans are being altered. Yeah.
And we had already made a consent that was going to be four in the front on way back, four in the front and two going down Temple. And because of the master plan and all that, we flipped it to a four down Temple and two in the front. And now there might be something else showing up. So we just have to look at it again, is all I'm saying, and vet it again.
If I can just comment on all of that. So the intent with the filing of the demo permit was to just get this moving as we're seeing today. Mm-hmm. As I had expressed in the past, it's not something I have to do tomorrow, mm-hmm. okay? And it's something that I just want to do the correct way. Mm-hmm. Now, as far as the number of units go and the site plan and all the other stuff, from a DOT standpoint, we're not adding any more units. We're not adding any more driveways. We're not touching anything that way. We're just taking down two units and putting two more units over here. Pretty simple. The only thing that's going to be different from the site as far as quantification will simply be whether we go forward with a community center, you know, something for the community, or at this point, just leave it off, come back in later on, just go in with a site plan for the duplex, remove that one, same number of units, all the driveways, nothing changes. The only thing we're doing is adding a septic system and a building and a location that fits beautifully on.
And that would require an amended site plan.
That would require an amended site plan.
That's
and
the
then
basics
includes
of the whole thing.
What's that?
They do have a right to amend the site plan.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Not
and that's what they're
that.
Trying to do. Heritage has got their issues, I understand. But he has a right to amend his site plan. The other side of this, The house is very close to the road. And Route 3A, unfortunately, is going to be a turn lane there. You can't get it from both sides. It's going to be taking land. So the house is going to be really too close to the right of way. Everything we wanted to get farther back. This is not a slow street out there. It's a 40 mile an hour street. And it's a stop and go in that area. So if he wants to go in with another change of a site plan, which is a minor change, technically, okay, and everybody has done this for years. They go in with a site plan, things don't go the way they want, they want to change something, they go back to the board. Not just us, the board. Okay, and the Heritage Commission, whoever gets involved with the board then.
Right.
Okay.
So we need to determine where in this process he should be, and now it's at the point where a new site plan should be submitted to the planning board that's going to include removal of the old home, the addition of the two, and if you decide to do your community room, whatever, build that later. That's, you know, neither here or there. And then at that point, because he's going to request to demolish, he's already requested, then it'll go to the Heritage Commission and then back to the planning board and then through. Is that correct?
Yep.
If that's correct, then he doesn't get out of compliance. He stays in compliance, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep, he's going
to
stay in compliance.
If all of a sudden you take a building off, it's like, but you didn't agree to that, you know, so.
Right, so now he's going to have amended. Yeah.
The amended plan will bring it into what he's changing it. So it is in compliance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll go back into compliance.
I didn't want it to go purposely into non-compliance.
Yep.
That was
nope.
My question.
Then
what do you do when that happens?
It's not looking to go into non-compliance.
So if I may speak for the staff, because we have been involved in this, and I know our names have been brought up as having opinions. We have no opinions. We have legal opinions. We have no personal opinions. The ordinance, as you read the Heritage Ordinance, does not really speak to this situation. That's one fact that we should probably amend if that is so your choice going forward. But there is nothing that legally says that the developer must file the amended site plan before the Heritage process starts.
Okay.
There's nothing that says that. They can run very parallel, and that can be very helpful, because if the Heritage process was to start and the public hearing was to be held and the information was to be gathered, the planning board might find that actually useful when the amended site plan comes to them. Just for the fact that the public hearing has started and the process has started does not throw him out of compliance. Throwing him out of compliance would be Mr. Blackwell signing the permit and Mr. Mora demolishing the house. That's not what we're saying. We're saying hold the public hearing, get the public input, get that public input, because the planning board may find that very helpful.
So they could run in parallel.
They could run in parallel.
As a board member, we really don't have much say on it. Selectmen, okay? It's the Heritage and Planning Board.
And I would agree with you there as well. Unfortunately, we got to a stalemate.
Yes, yes. Now we need to get this train back on track.
So the governing body gets to break the stalemate.
I've been involved with this many times over the years in my line of work. You become a building inspector, you will learn. Okay, and we run across this a lot with certain buildings and towns that I've worked with. They come back and they came back with the boards and amended stuff. Okay. The demo permit's not being issued because they're going to amend it to do something else to get it blessed, fine.
Now and this is something I'm unclear of, if you decide to demo a building, let's just use, for example, you're going with 66, you decide, you know what, I'm going to go with 64, I'm going to demo the building, does that require an amended site plan? If you're removing something off it.
It should not require an amended site plan because you're not building anything
not
after
building
that.
Anything
it's going to be open space.
I'm not sure if that's true or not, so I can't comment.
Yeah. Very true on that, but that's me, okay, guys? I've been through this, that's why I'm saying what I'm saying.
Jeff, do you have any input to that? Is that a requirement?
I agree. If you were to check with town council, I believe that they would tell you that he could go ahead and demo that building.
Yep.
And that would not require an amended site plan because he's not adding, he's removing from.
Correct. Or he could just go in with amending the site plan at this point.
Right. I'm just trying to understand the process and figure out where it is and how to get it moving. So at this point in time, you are 100% sure that you want to remove the building.
Yeah.
So there's no more questions, no more ambiguity. You're not going to relook. No. This is, no. Your plan is going this way.
So again, I'm not a lawyer, but if somebody tells me they're going to build 20 buildings and we go through all this, you know, lawyers looking at it and all this, and you build 18, I don't know if that's what the site plan says. Fire department's expected to see 20 when they get in there, right? Again, I'm not a lawyer, but that's another conversation for another day. So I want to make sure he doesn't go into compliance on purpose, which sounds like he's not.
But I've been through this where they decided not to build two or three units because things changed a little bit during the construction phase. And when I issued the final, that's it. They can't just add those units on. Just because it's on there, it's done. The final inspections are done. That's what the building permit is. That's done. Okay, that's how I take it from that point down. And the planning board has always agreed with that because they have elected not to build it. And it's in writing. Mm-hmm. It's not just I said so. It's in writing. That's what they wanted, and that's fine. That's why I based the final inspections on.
Now, there was also some questions or concerns when it was first submitted, and I thought there was like notes of using the building, but it wasn't included. Was that? No, sure. It was always the intention was to have 66, two would be in there, and then you decided to change. Okay.
Was that always a two-family?
I'm not sure. It was converted at one time or another. I don't know how long.
It's been that way. Jeremy lived in the main house, and they rented out the second floor.
I have no record of that. I'll let it go at that. Well, I looked for that. That's what I was asking.
We've sat here in these chairs, and not so much you, Steve, because this is your first year, but with other businesses in town that have changed things on a site plan and not gone through the process, and it's come before us.
Comes to the planning board, not before us.
Correct. But we've had to sit here and talk about it, and it's come before our board before because the process is.
But the final saying is not us. It's not the planning board.
I understand that, but if you remember Mel's.
Yeah, that was temporary or not temporary.
They just moved a food truck, and mm-hmm. they had to do an amended site plan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Spooky World did too.
Yeah.
Did their job.
So,
they got it.
So it is important that we follow the same process. But I think it's also important that we have a Heritage Commission for a reason,
mm-hmm.
and that we can't undermine their job in this. Okay.
Yes, but their job also cannot be to block progress.
That's part of the process mm-hmm. here, too.
So we're learning. So mm-hmm. the zoning ordinance needs to be changed, not to maybe be handed out why it's an active construction site.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe anytime anyone comes in the future and says the house is going to stay, it goes on the notes on the drawing, so it's legally bound, right? I mean, we have to get that out there because, again, NRPC, the guy's a lawyer for the whole 13 regions, highways, malls. He heard it that way. I heard it. Michael's a lawyer. Who's the other? James Buffetti, Assistant Attorney General. We all heard the same thing. So I'm not a lawyer, but they did not recommend it go in the notes either. So in the future, we'll just have to make sure we make it upon approval or something.
But that would not prevent him from coming
back now,
and amending the site plan.
No, we can still amend it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
What you're saying is not uncommon, but they can
go
back and re-amend it.
If we go back to the beginning,
yeah.
Before even coming in here, I could have demolished the house, just as I did with the barn, just as I did with the other barn.
Right.
It would have been my right to do that. There is a process for that to happen. We're following that process. When we came into the board, we didn't say that this was going to be a definitive, this is staying. We made it perfectly clear. We hadn't been in the building. The people were living in the building. They were going to continue to live in the building for quite some time after we acquired the property, and they did. And after they moved out is when we started getting into the building and starting to look at it and starting to realize and after we met with DOT and had to give up the roadway and all that other stuff, all of that started to come in and play into the big mix when we started looking at the overall, you know, project. Our decisions were made after we took everything into consideration, and that's how we're moving forward with it. But again, the right to remove the building existed from day one at our acquisition, regardless of the site plan. And that's by this town's ordinance.
You're correct. But again, I'm questioning why we give permission for DOT early. These are the things I don't think would have caught. It's because they're aged out or in retiring. But at some point, we have to stop giving permits until DOT signs in. We're saying, oh, when they do, you know. But that's something we need to talk to it as a board.
Yep.
And I agree with you. You had the right to do it. I agree with you.
Again, I'll speak again for someone who's lived in this town his entire life and is slowly seeing all the older properties gone. And when they're gone, they're gone. And I'll be on. And I've known you for a long time. Coach's nephew in baseball, and in my opinion, we were all led to believe the house was going to stay. We were all led to believe that. I firmly believe that. So I kind of feel like maybe we weren't. I don't know if it was just something that was said to help the process or not. I don't know, and I wouldn't call you a liar. I just think that is definitely some miscommunication here. If this was the intent all along.
We couldn't make that determination until after we got into the home and looked at things.
And he could have also, right from the beginning, as he said, I'm demolishing the house.
Mm-hmm. As I did with the barn.
So I think his intentions were pure. Yeah.
I mean, if you look back, I'm sorry.
If you look
back, part of the process was we actually walked through the barn.
Mm-hmm.
We actually took the time to try to see what we could do with that.
Mm-hmm.
There was an interest in moving that barn down the street. I don't think we could, in the end, have done that. But there was an interest in people moving that barn. After we got into it, we saw the same thing we saw in the house. They went through it. There were a lot of things that were taken out of that house. The horses, unfortunately, did some damage on the lower level. By the time you look at it and what was original in the place, there just wasn't enough to make it worth, you know, salvaging.
Mm-hmm.
It's not much different in this particular home. Mm-hmm. You know, I've spent a little bit of time talking to some other people that did some work in town that mm-hmm. did some reconditions on some homes, and they told me point blank, never again. They wouldn't do it. They were not happy with the end result. And from my standpoint, I can't have a rental. That thing's full of, it's got lead paint all over the house.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to risk my family by turning that into a rental because I can't prevent somebody from bringing children in.
Mm-hmm.
And if that child all of a sudden chose lead paint, whether they got it somewhere else or not, that's on me.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
And if I start tearing out all of the woodwork, all the floors, because that's where it is, when I start doing all of that lead abatement, there's not going to be much left. And again, there's very little there today anyway. Like when we started looking at the whole process and everything that we need to do to try to protect ourselves, it just doesn't make sense. And it's sad, but that's the way it is with a lot of old homes. That's why, if you look at the city of Manchester, that's why a lot of homes in the city sat for so long because it was so full of lead. Nobody wanted to touch them. They just tore them down because it was cheaper for them to do that than to try to abate them. So that's the kind of stuff that, unfortunately, we can't do and we didn't know about until we start looking at these things. We did find out about the asbestos.
Mm-hmm.
We actually went in and removed all the asbestos, which we'd have to do anyway as part of the process of demolishing. But we did go through and we did do all of those studies,
yeah.
you know, early on to see what was there.
Yeah.
Lead paint wasn't one of them, unfortunately.
You didn't do a lead paint study?
Because
you have to assume if it's prior to 78 that it's got
right.
lead.
We didn't do that. We were more concerned with how much asbestos do we have.
Yeah.
And then that came up.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, because being in the paint industry, that's the thing they tell you. Pre-78,
right?
You have to assume in 1960, you have to absolutely.
Right.
So, I still would like to hear from the Herald.
Oh yeah.
I would
yeah.
like to hear from them.
I was just going to suggest that.
But so, does any members of the Heritage want to come up? Anybody? You're the ones we haven't heard from. Come on up, Carl. Come on. Hey.
It seems that if there was a site plan.
Carl Frank, Joe Frank.
I'm sorry, what?
Name and address, please.
Oh, I didn't know I had to do that.
People at home.
Carl Frank, 253 Charles Bancroft.
Yeah.
It seems to me if there was, it's true that from day one, if you wanted the demolition permit to tear it down, that's fine.
Yep, yep.
But there is a site plan. It was an understanding. I can tell you that in Manchester, I work in the Planning Community Development Department in Manchester. If someone changes course like we're talking about here, they do have to go back to the planning board. They do have to. And it's not normally a problem. It doesn't necessarily have to be a problem now. We're not here to tell somebody what they can and can't do with their property. We're just trying to find a way, like the name of our organization implies, save the heritage of the town. Mm-hmm. There's a number of ways we could do that. If we can't find a way to do it, then we can find a way to do it. But we're here to try.
Mm-hmm. And have you guys given any thought to maybe trying to see if we can move the house?
Well, the feasibility of such a thing, I think, was asked and answered when the question came up about the barn. And as I understand it correctly, that was a no-go because Eversource didn't want to work with us because the power lines are right there. Mm-hmm. So, unfortunately, we have that working against us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if I could add, we did discuss that during the Heritage Commission, and I suggested going forward, the Heritage Commission starts needing to build up some funds. So in the situation of this, they need land, they need money to move it, they need a foundation. You know, it's unfortunate, it's not a cheap, easy thing to do. Mm-hmm. And then, as we found out, because of the wires where the power lines are, to move the barn would have caused, we would have had to cut it in half. What would that house do?
Right.
You know, you'd have to. And the tough part, it would be great to retain it, move it down to the center of town, but that costs.
Well, even to the town-owned property that's right there.
Well, that's what
just south of the site.
Right, on the other side of the power lines.
One of the
lessons we learned with the Bixby House is that the town or whomever wasn't in a position to act quick enough to do something with it. So it was kind of, there was no time to do something meaningful.
Yeah.
Even if the option was there.
That house was fairly trashed before the fire.
Right, that's true too. That factor was true as well, yeah.
Unfortunately, the Heritage Commission is kind of bound and powerless because they have great intentions, but they don't have the funding to back it up to be able to take action and save these old houses.
Right.
Not just here. A lot of the Heritage Commission has got the same problems. No funding for restoration and stuff like that, or relocating. And when we talked about the bond being moved, that was the issue there, jacking it up and moving it down. We couldn't get underneath the power lines because you're getting up too high and they're right there. So that killed that process. Plus the bond had been modified so much that in order to pick it up, it would have been difficult.
Yeah.
Okay, because the bottom half was cut up so much you couldn't get the top half to set on top of the lid. Things get old. Things change. I hate to say this, but what we live with. Look at Litchfield. I've been here all my life. Hasn't changed a bit, have it? You just can't go in the woods anymore. Okay?
So we need to work
on
the
other side of it. Route 3A has changed so much. You know?
So we need to work on funding for the group.
The Heritage, yes. That's the one thing they're missing. Funding in order to, you'd have to lift the house, move the house, have a foundation, have a piece of land, then have the money to put in to restore it.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge cost. The developer didn't want to do it where the house sits.
Yeah.
Can you imagine moving it and then repairing the damage that will occur as it's being shuffled?
That just happened in London. They just recently, a couple old houses over there on 101-102, but the old chicken farm used to be.
Mm-hmm.
They just burnt them down recently.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's a matter of what you want to do or what you can do with them. You know, they've been there a long time.
I guess if I had a suggestion, it would be for Reg and the Heritage and the Planning Board to fall, just get that process together and follow that process and work together to see if this is as painless as possible, if it's going to happen.
As we understand now, the Heritage can continue with their hearing and their process, and the Planning Board can expect an amended site plan with the removal of the house, and then these two can merge together.
For a step one, step two.
That sound right to you?
It does, unfortunately. So it sounds like, so yeah. I understand, the Heritage process is going to run starting now, right?
Yeah. Did that sound right to you?
Yeah, that sounds great.
And Heritage?
Yeah, like I said, we're just trying to
figure out how this needs to play out.
See what the feasibility is of doing it.
Yes, yeah. And I know that we did look at, you know, for the barn down the street, but I think one of the fallacies that that came out after the fact was that you can't put a structure on that land because of the
correct
deed restrictions that were when it was granted to the town.
That was a court case that was put on that by the state in relation to open space and stuff like that.
I think it was
no
fishing game easement.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
I know we're just trying to get a sidewalk in. We can do that. We read the deed the other night in the Conservation Commission. And so at first they said there was going to be no asphalt allowed because apparently there was they were trying to pave the parking lot at one time.
Mm-hmm.
But because this is the sidewalk is considered for recreation, it therefore falls into that category where it can be done. So I guess that would be one of the downfalls of trying to use that site.
And that was a court case too. That's why it is the way it is. Because of wetland violations many years ago. And this is what the agreement was between the state, the town, and the owner.
Okay.
No, if anybody hasn't seen, Kyle's done a fantastic job of taking 360 pictures of it, mm-hmm. as well as drone footage on the outside, which will help retain some of the history, which is really cool videos.
I need to find a way to... I'm still working on that. This is new to me, and
drones?
I absolutely loved how it came out.
Yep.
So I need to find a way to, you know, document it someplace other than locally on my computer.
Yeah.
You know, because that's like, all right, how do I move this to a website or something? I'm not there yet, but I'm working on it.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Carl.
All right, thanks, Edison.
Thank you.
Thank you. I see some of my friends in the back there.
I know.
You guys have anything you want to add? You good? Thank you.
I just might have to walk home tonight. My Jeep's not going to have any tires.
Well, all right.
Not that group.
So you kind of know where you're going to go.
Oh, no. Gail changed her mind.
What the?
Gail wants to come up.
Oh, Gail wants to come up? All right. Before we move on. Okay.
She came by her horse tonight.
Gail Barringer, 398 Charles Bancroft Highway. Very, very briefly, the Heritage Commission is not trying to block this process.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We found Reggie Moreau to be very gracious, welcomed us into the house,
mm-hmm.
Explained things. When I asked questions, I got an answer to every question.
Mm-hmm.
We're in a difficult spot
mm-hmm.
because we haven't held the hearing because we didn't understand for sure what the process was, but we are not trying to block the process.
I'm sorry for those words.
So thank you for guiding us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gail.
It's appreciated. Okay.
I got a picture of you on a horse recently.
Very good. Okay. So everyone knows what they need to do. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming in, everybody.
Thank you.
We do appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay. Up next, Litchfield Fire Department Work Invest New Hampshire program. Ms. Kleiner, what do you got here?
We have Chief Nickel and Mr. Kelly here.
Mr. Kelly, yes.
And they're going to speak to this training program that they'd like your permission.
Okay.
Hi, good evening.
Hi.
Thanks for letting us come in and speak to you. So this is a project that went into place in 2023. The governor set aside $2.5 million into a fund that was looked over and managed by Work Invest. It's basically part of the retention and recruitment
mm-hmm.
Program that the state is trying to put on to get people into EMT and advanced EMT programs. So any employer, whether it be private or fire, any person that comes in that wants EMT training, we would put in the payment for that class.
Mm-hmm.
When they graduate and successfully complete the program, the town would then get reimbursed the cost of the program. So it's the cost up to $2,000 for anything like uniforms or other
equipment.
costs that, or equipment that they had to provide. There is a stipulation, as you can read, with the 50% of wages, that that does not pertain to any of our employees, because we only pay for the class, we don't pay for the hours, unless it's a...
Yep.
So we're just looking for the approval that any person going into a class from this point forward, the town can put in and get reimbursed for the program. Unfortunately, it won't come back into our fund, it would then go into the general account, so...
We're happy with that.
I knew you would be.
How long are the classes typically? Say it.
So the EMT classes could be anywhere from, there's some that run 3 to 4 weeks full-time during the day. There's others that run overnights for 6 to 8 months.
Okay.
So there's a variety of classes that we sign people up for. Some are eager to get it done within the 3 to 4 weeks, if they can take the time off and go to get the training. Others will take the 2 nights and the weekends.
Yep.
So it's usually a couple hours a night and a couple weekends a month.
Okay, so basically anyone who's on your workforce is eligible for this, if
right.
they are not certified already.
Correct. If they're not certified. If they're EMTs and they want to go to advanced school,
yep.
this pays for that also.
Pays for that
or
also.
Reimburses us for that also.
Now, is it just fire? Is it police too? Can they get the same training?
It can be anybody.
It can be anybody that, you as long as they're it. Employed by the town, we can put in the reimbursement.
Yeah. Building inspectors, because he gives a lot of heart attacks out there during the day.
Sign him up.
Heartburn, maybe not.
Give him the AED first.
Yeah, put Cruz lights in his little car.
I'm sorry to have a little kid over this.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions about this? Or
nope.
No, it's another way the fire department's saving us money. This is the second time in a row.
Plus, it gets a little more people involved. If something goes down, there's somebody there to help.
And trains, training. Yeah.
So do we have to have a motion on this to approve it?
Yes.
I think we do.
So make a motion. There we go
your,
for
what's
it.
Your motion?
I make a motion that we approve the work invest New Hampshire program for the under the care of the Litchfield Fire Department.
We have a motion from Mr. Lynch.
I'll second it.
We have a second from Mr. Gannon. Any further discussion?
I just have one question.
Sure.
It's under the fire department? Or is it out of town? I just want to make sure. Not that it matters,
so,
but I just want to.
I mean, I right now, you could have another department, but I'd rather keep the paperwork and the and things under the fire department as they are actively aware of the,
yep.
the
yep.
program.
So how would they pay, and then we come back to the town, and then you'd transfer it
they'd
back to them?
With, they'd
but
work
yeah,
with Ms. White,
would.
Yes, to
beforehand, right?
Yes.
Beforehand?
Yeah. We had worked on getting one other person that was on our roster but employed by another town that started the program. When he got released from that other town, we kind of worked with him to get his money back, and so we did help one person. So
good.
That was my question. Thank you.
Sounds like a great program. Nice work.
And technically, we're town employees, so you could get this training.
Yeah, we got to pass.
Yep. We collect the paycheck.
Cheapest town employees we ever
had. All those in favor say aye. Opposed? Motion carries 4-0-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I'm sorry for the
appreciate
time.
All
time
you
delay.
Do.
Definitely.
Yeah, there must be something else here.
Mr. Nichol is up for the Chief Nichol is up for the next one as well.
What is this one? Oh, EMS budget request for the CERT team?
No, Hawkers and Peddlers, what's that on?
EMS for the...
We got the fire department here, Kevin.
Team.
Stay with the program.
I am. Hawkers and Peddlers is next.
Oh, I'm sorry. The agenda is...
While we have
course.
Chief Nichol here, let's go into the EMS budget request for the CERT team.
So, as everybody knows, I had money in the 2024 budget for emergency management in order to start the CERT team. The funds were cut by the budget committee.
Not me.
Which puts us in a predicament that I have currently 10 members or 10 people that want to join the CERT team, and I don't have a budget in order to provide equipment or to pay for their background checks at the state level, which I believe we should do where they're volunteering their time. So just on the 10 people that I have, which I believe we may get more people that'll attend the next meeting, just for the 10 people, between outfitting them with the proper equipment and also doing background checks, I'm up to $920. And had my budget not been cut $1,500, I would have had the proper amount to do what I need to do.
Yep.
So I'm either asking to see, I don't know how it works, whether I can deficit spend that amount and then it gets covered at the end of the year, or we transfer money, or what we do, but we need to do something, otherwise I can't start a cert team.
So my suggestion is when you ask that question, you look over at Karen. Miss Finance.
Get her checkbook out.
No, she'll tell you. And
can't transfer.
Yeah.
We can't transfer, but
okay. Can so we? I'm looking for suggestions of what I can do.
Can we find money somewhere?
Background checks at $15?
No. The cert at $25?
What's that?
Cert 25?
It's $25 for each background check.
I have volunteers with 15.
Yeah. Really?
Well, maybe.
Didn't we try that with you?
We tried that once before, yeah.
Because you were a paid employee.
Something about municipal employee.
Oh.
Yeah, we'd have to
look
into that.
So I believe volunteers.
Okay.
We can look into that. I mean, but that's a little safe.
Right.
It also, unfortunately, Chase and I would need a background check as well.
Right, so you're actually not into that 10, so now we're up to 12.
Okay.
So I asked Chief Nickel to come tonight because I feel it's important that the board makes a motion, because not only is this likely to put that line item in a deficit, there is a chance that this as a department will become in deficit. Now what would happen is that means that Ms. White needs to track this so that we are underspent in some other department. The problem comes into a department head is not supposed to knowingly put their department into.
Correct.
So he could, if he has the board's approval, and we will watch it, and I don't see an issue moving forward for the end of the year, considering that there's other monies that haven't been spent from salaries that are out there that weren't filled. But.
Well, that was my question, is do we have money somewhere that we can fund this from?
Well.
Without going in the red.
My question is, the budget committee cut it, right?
Yeah.
And so it didn't get into the final budget, right?
Right. I believe this is part of that 2% across
2%.
The board.
Correct.
Which defunded it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And you're coming here to ask us to say it's going on the ballot to be defunded, basically, right?
Basically,
they're asking
yeah.
us for the money.
Well, where are they going to get the money?
From
other sectors of your budget, I hope, right?
We're going to make sure there's other departments that still have funds in it enough to cover it so that the bottom line is not overspent.
Can that be done legally if it's been taken out?
So
the budget committee gives the residents a recommended budget.
Right.
And one of the discussions it's always had is
it's a bottom line
budget. It's a bottom line budget. You can find the money somewhere.
Right.
That I can live with.
Yeah.
I'm asking that question.
I agree with that.
Okay,
speaking for myself, not for the rest of the board, I would be extremely grateful if you could find the money somewhere.
Basically, cut back on your fuel charges. I mean, I'm sorry.
Well, I think going forward, we're going to look for grant money specifically for cert teams.
Mm-hmm.
But kind of have an issue at the moment because we need to get these individuals background checked.
Yep.
Primex has agreed to come and give them training.
Okay.
So we need to do this. We don't have an opportunity to look for that grant money, and it's under $1,000. We'll find the $1,000 somewhere else.
I do have a meeting actually the snowstorm that we were supposed to have that we didn't have. I was supposed to have a meeting with the state. It got postponed, but part of that meeting is to go over what kind of grant money is available out there for the CERT team.
I don't know if 900 covers just based the people you have. You don't have money if you get more people. So I think 900 is probably not the right number. Maybe 1,500 or 2,000 or something like that, because people want to have the parade, and we have to have bodies to monitor the streets and stuff.
Yeah, did you get the list that Diane collected at the last meeting? Does that include the 10 people? Is that part of it?
That was part, yeah. I went through the paperwork yesterday of everybody that so far has submitted for the background stuff. Mm-hmm. So, we may be able to find a way to get equipment possibly donated, possibly, but, you know, I still have to look at what if I can't.
Yeah, exactly. You do. Let's find a way to make this happen. I'll leave it to you folks who handle the monies.
We'll do it. Yeah.
Everybody okay with that?
Yeah, it's a one-time cost for the background checks, right?
Mm-hmm.
But any new person coming on board, and then if equipment can't happen, there's money needed there.
Yep.
Is it really going to be a one-time thing, or we have to look at this every year?
It'll
something
be
in the
ongoing,
budget.
It'll be in his budget.
Next year, next year, emergency manager will make sure that we have the funding in there.
Okay. Perfect.
That was an easy line to remove because it wasn't, you know, it was just
new
talk
mm-hmm.
at that point in time.
So hopefully this year when we have the parades and the budget committee members see this, they will be willing to leave that money alone.
We have parade committee members that are, it's not a parade committee. We have citizens that are willing to come to the budget next year, the budget committee, and speak on behalf of this line item.
Okay, the new thing.
And it's more about just the parade, too. Doug did, I attended, I signed up. Doug did a fantastic job. Luann Ballmer was there and Brian McHugh,
mm-hmm.
and they're on Londonderry's, and they talked about all the different things. They talked about the search and rescues, all the training that you could do. You can go, it's not just directing traffic for parades, it's a lot more.
Okay. So, do we need a motion for anything for this, or are we just, no, I don't think we do. We're just giving you direction.
I'm good with that.
Okay, very good. We'll make it happen. We'll figure it out.
We'll make it happen.
Yep. Okay, do we have them for anything else? Is that it?
That's it.
If you hurry next door, there might be some cupcakes left.
Oh, did you know where I was going?
You are the health officer, right? You can say you're coming to inspect.
I'm going to go assist the health officer.
You're going to go assist? Oh, Jeff probably likes cupcakes, too.
I'll swing by one day, Doug, and fill out the background check information.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming in. Thanks for everything. I think it's worthy. Before we move on to our next item, last week we had a fire in town which claimed the life of a resident. It's Janet Hee over in Century Lane, who's been a resident of this town for a lot of years, worked in school for a lot of years, and just want to send out our thoughts and condolences to her family. And I understand they've started a GoFundMe and holding a spaghetti dinner and all this other stuff to help the family out, and just they have our full support. If anything we can do, please let us know. She's a nice lady.
Actually, it wasn't a GoFundMe. It's a part of the Greg Hill Foundation matching grants, and it was $5,000. And last I looked, it was almost $65,000.
Yeah, that's what I had heard too. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's a little different than a GoFundMe.
65,000.
Yeah, 65,000.
Which is absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah.
It does show what kind of people we have in this town. So, all right. Just wanted to do a quick little thing. Thank you, Kim, for that.
Mm-hmm.
Up next, hawkers and peddlers request. Ms. Kleiner.
Yeah, two of them.
So we have two hawkers and peddlers. First being Michelle Bonner, and she represents Trinity Solar. They both the company and the individual have submitted lengthy application as well as a certificate of authority to do business within the state of New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm.
They have also included their certificate of liability insurance and gone through the necessary background checks. We would like to ask the board for permission to issue a hawkers and peddlers license to Michelle Bonner from Trinity Solar.
Okay. And this will be someone that'll be going basically door to door trying to sell solar.
Correct. The company will be.
The company will be, yeah. Company representative.
Sunrun Infinity, I've worked with them for the last four or five years.
Yep. Just so the people in town know what's going on.
Yeah. Just the same thing.
Yes, and
you've been issuing permits all the time.
Yeah.
We have vehicle information, which will be on hand at the police department.
Okay, yep. And they've passed all the checks and all that? Checks and balances, okay.
I make a motion, we approve them.
Oh, hold on. Is her name Michelle or Joanne?
I got
Joanne. Joanne Michelle, sorry. Joanne
Bonner.
Okay.
Yep.
Yes.
Thank you.
You got that.
Yeah, you caught me there, too.
Mm-hmm.
That's good. Yeah, it's over here.
All right, Kevin, you may continue with your motion.
Make a motion that we approve these two hawkers.
Well, we haven't talked about the second one yet.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
The second one's not the same.
Let's talk about them both.
Yep. Do we want to do them separate or together?
Separate, please.
Yes.
I'll make a motion for Joanne Bonner to get a hawkers and peddlers license.
From
Trinity Solar.
Beginning of 2/26/2024, and they only run for 1 year, correct?
Yep.
Yep.
So 2/26/25.
I'll second.
1 year.
Yep. All right. So we have a motion from Mr. Lynch.
Second.
And I will say it was amended by Mr. Gannon seconded by Ms. Queenan. So
sorry about that.
No, that's perfect. No, that's perfect.
No, so, that's part of the regulation to year.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 4-0-0. So the second one we have is...
The second one we have is a Reginald Pepin,
yep.
And
okay.
The company name is Sunrun. This is also door-to-door solar, and I'm asking the board to table this at the moment for me.
Okay, yeah, because the description says windows, roofing, and siding.
Yes, so there's some discrepancy as I look at the application.
Okay.
It says solar on the application.
It says door-to-door sales manager, solar representative.
That's basically, yeah. Sunrun doesn't really get into windows, doors, and stuff like that. There's something something's messed up here.
Yeah. So, yeah, let's table it.
Yeah. So we'll table it until we get more clarification.
I would like to ask for more information.
Yeah,
absolutely. I agree with you 100%. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
I didn't know it was different compared to that.
Okay. So we table one, we pass one. Up next, we have town events, Fishing Derby, May 18th, and the Easter Scavenger Hunt on March 13th.
Yes, so the reason I put both of these together is they are both actually being sponsored by town boards. The Fishing Derby on May 18th, staff, we met with George Lavash, who is running the Fishing Derby this year.
Yep.
Highway police, fire, building inspector, and I met with them. We went through the process. We feel it's in good shape. All of our departments know what is needed. But it is actually something that has in the past come forward. And the board has at least given an approval, even though it's sponsored by the Conservation Commission. So I did submit a permit application from all the information that Mr. Lavash gave to us, and we've just asked the board to sign off on that. The second one is through the spirit of Litchfield, which is a recreation commission, and they have asked for an Easter scavenger hunt on March 13th. What their ask is to have a table at Town Hall in the parking lot, and we will work, we haven't met with fire and highway and police yet. This request just came in the other day. We will.
Sorry.
We'll meet just to see where the police, especially the police, because of the logistics here at Town Hall, where they would like the table. But we spoke about it being something very...
Yep. I'm down the wrong way. Jackson, keep going.
We spoke about it being something very similar to the trunk or treat.
Yep.
You know, they would just be coming, they'd be picking up their eggs and leaving. They wouldn't, it wouldn't be... Yeah. Anything where the public would be staying in the parking lot for any length of time.
So they're not looking for eggs.
They're not looking for eggs here. They're just a stop on the scavenger hunt.
Now, last time they did it at multiple locations, so this is one of many, right?
One of many.
Yeah.
So they'll be at Sawmill, they'll be at other recreational facilities. This would just be one stop on the map. We think we can make it work, similar to like how we do with the trunk or treat. It is a Saturday morning, 10 a.m. to 12, so it's a relatively quiet time. There's no business being done here at Town Hall. There was relatively, I think it's a small ask. They were also asking for use of our sign to advertise. So we mentioned that we could actually, you know, change the sign and advertise the hunt.
We may need to check with them because March 13th is a Wednesday.
It's the 30th.
March 30th, okay.
It's March 30th. They want the sign as of the 13th. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. So it's Saturday, March 30th, 10 a.m. to 12,
yeah,
which
so
is a Saturday.
13th is not a big deal. It's just wanting something for something that's going to be held on the 3rd or 30th.
Does anybody have anything?
So do we need to make a motion to approve Fish and Derby and Scavenger?
Just give them the approval.
I think you can give approval. Conservation and Recreation have already given approval on both of these. The only issue was the spirit of Litchfield using the parking lot, and as long as we can work out the logistics with the police department, we'd ask that the
we're having the Fish and Derby, I assume, again at Parker Park.
That's what I hear.
Yep.
Yes.
Unfortunately, yeah. George's Ice Fish and Derby got canceled. He was going to have one on.
Yeah.
Need a little ice up there for us. You know, it's minor.
Going to be 50.
So they'll. The Litchfield Police Department is working with Mr. Lavash, and Highway will be providing the cones, as they have in the past. That is 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. On Saturday, May 18th.
Okay. Year for this.
15 years and under.
What's that?
15 years and under is the age limit.
Yep. Because at 16, you need a license.
Yep. Until you're, what, 70, 75, then you don't need a license anymore? You might see some older folks out there. Nope, nope, we're just discussing the Derby and the Easter egg hunt.
We haven't gone very far.
You're going for the Easter bunny?
Yep, we're still on it. So, I think it's a great thing. I mean, being someone who took part in Fish and Derby when I was a kid, I think it's great that it's back.
I actually helped start it back up when I was on the recreation.
Yep. We never had permission. We still did it.
Yeah, they just used to do it. Somebody would just announce it, and they would get, and they would.
And we all showed up.
Get them to come over and stock the brook, and
yep.
We used to have it at Redfields.
Yep.
So, yeah. And Chase Brook. And, yeah, that's Redfield.
And Brickyard, too. We had a Brickyard, place.
Too, yeah.
So we
wasn't that by Mark Lane, too? Or,
Mark Lane, yeah. Mark. Duchamp's old the pond up
that,
there.
That's the pond up there. That was no fun. We need Brooks.
Trout like Brooks.
So we just have to approve Fishing Derby for March 18th as well as Scavenger Hunt the 30th with the use of the sign starting on March 13th.
Yes.
I'll second it.
Should they possibly use the sign at the dump as well? Go to the dump.
We can put it on both. I know the Fishing Derby specifically asked for the sign at the dump at the transfer station.
We have the sign man here tonight. That's something we could do, right? Okay. If it's feasible. Okay. Yep.
It's easy enough to do.
Perfect.
Okay.
I think so.
We still got a sign out there. It doesn't use much.
Very good. Good luck. All right. Let's see, up next. Well, you know what? Before we go to next.
Let's go right,
I see an old friend sitting in the crowd tonight. She's been sitting here patiently all night. Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you just watching? Oh, just listening? No business?
No business.
No? Okay, because we did not do public input.
Yeah, I was just
so I'd like
say
to
that.
Open the floor for public input. Are there any members of the public that would like to speak? No? Hearing none? We will close public input at 7:49. Which it also opened on. So, very good. All right. Up next.
Economic development.
They were on my list.
Economic Development Committee survey and membership renewal.
Would you like me to speak to it? Sorry.
Yes, please.
Yep.
Please do. I don't know anything about it.
I'm going to speak. All right. We met, I believe, last week.
Yeah.
They're all blending together. We have finalized a survey to go out to the town. This is it. It's only a front and back page. Let me actually open it up. I did send one item back to you. Oh, did you put it here? Facebook page, transfer station. Did you open it up? You can see the survey? Did you open up? Can you see it in your portal?
That right there? Oh.
Oh, it's up there, yeah. So on the right-hand
side.
Oh,
yeah, I have it. It's in blue.
It's telling you where the survey is available at the town hall, the library, the transfer station. We can also find it on the town website and town Facebook page. I'm not sure a Q&R code is going out with this one or
yes.
Not. Okay, good. So it's only front and back page. It's, I think, pretty intuitive to fill out. It's just a first survey. We may have two or three more coming. We're just trying to gauge if the town, where they stand on economic development in general. So I'm going to let Ms. Kleiner, you did speak to the town moderator about having this survey. And John, you're the backup moderator, right? handed out during town vote.
Yes.
Right? So can you, I wasn't part of that conversation. Can you reiterate what you spoke about with the town moderator?
Certainly. And I'll point out that there's one change to the survey coming. It's misnumbered. So
<Yeah.
laughs> 1, 2, and 4. I'll make that correction. So I did reach out at the committee's request to moderator Perry, who did say that they could have a table, and we will make signs that they are only there for people to walk up to the table, fill out the survey, and we'll have a box for them to drop it into. Should they so want to.
You're right. Or they could drop it off here at a later date.
Right. They could take it with them.
Thank you.
Totally up to them. We will have a QR code there that they could just walk by, scan the QR code, and take it on their phone and submit it electronically. There's not to be any discussion, especially discussion on items that are
listed.
Being voted on. This is strictly for pickup of the survey, taking up the survey and leaving. So we do have four committee members, well, three committee members and someone and a volunteer that are going to man the table that day.
And also the March 22nd deadline was so that we could report back to the Board of Selectmen within the year timeframe you gave us. So we want to get the numbers rolled up through SurveyMonkey. Should give us some statistics on that.
Should we extend the deadline? It's the first
question.
I think
question. So. Yeah, I think it's going to be filled out.
You think it'll be done by March 22nd?
Well, the voting is the 17th, right?
March 17th.
Oh, March 12th, excuse me. Yeah, I do, because it's already can start being rolled out, right?
Yes. Yeah. So the idea was that if the committee was good with it, which I believe they are, other than the numbering, I will get it over to Mr. Brunel. He's going to put it into a electronic survey, and then we can start it, at least on Facebook and the website, and we'll have copies here at Town Hall and these places. They'll be at the polls on the 12th. We'll ask for everything back by the 22nd. We actually scheduled a meeting of the Economic Development Committee to review. I don't remember that date. Selectman Queen, and I think it was the 27th, 29th.
27th comes to mind, but...
And then the thought was we'd have something for the Board of Selectmen at your first meeting in April. I think it's doable.
Yeah.
Yep.
Not too much of a crunch.
And Miss Connie Jackson out there has joined our committee.
She has. That's
yes,
why you're
as
here.
A voting member of the public.
Yep.
Very
good. Well, thank you.
Spent too much time.
So again, it's just quick 8 questions.
I think it's a very good survey. Mm.
Yeah.
I mean, I think, you know.
Get Michael out.
Oh, get out of the pool.
Michael's actually going to sit at the table.
Is he really?
Yeah.
Beautiful.
He doesn't talk much, so he's perfect.
He doesn't, yeah.
He hasn't changed.
Just like a screw.
I think it's going there. Bring
in the portal.
Some good information and data for us to
beautiful.
Look at.
Yeah.
I got that kicked out.
All right. Do we need to vote this? Or
no,
right?
You don't
it's
need
an update,
to vote
right?
That.
That's what it looks like.
We do need to ask for a vote on the second one because the economic development members are. It was only for 1 year,
okay.
The issuance of the committee. So they all expire March 2024.
Okay.
And we're asking for the board's approval to extend the committee another year.
Okay. We have a motion to extend the committee for another year.
Go for it, Steve.
So moved.
So
March 2025.
We have a motion from Mr. Gannon.
I'll second it.
A second from Mr. Lynch.
I'll let
further
speak.
Discussion? Kim, are you up for another year?
I'm up for another year. I can't get my portal to work, so I might be looking at your portals. Okay.
You might if you want.
All right.
Kevin's looking at it. He's cheating.
Oh, here. Like
also
in a memory form. It's a different
that,
form.
I'm also looking at it up here.
I can read it better up there.
What's that?
All the members have said that
agreed?
They would like to remain.
Perfect. Beautiful. Nice.
Okay.
Makes it easier.
Yeah.
Right.
We
that.
Just go for 2 days.
Right.
That means we don't have to have
all those in favor, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
Hey, did you just say 2 years?
No, 1 year.
1 year. Aye.
The motion carries 4-0-0.
I said 2.
Up next, we have an abatement.
Yep.
What do we have here?
And so there's nothing on the portal. I'm going to give it over to Ms. White.
Okay.
So back in January, I brought you a land use change tax to sign, which you guys did sign.
Yep.
I just found out the end of last week that property had changed ownership back in September.
Yep.
And the deed was entered wrong into our system.
Okay.
So the bill went to the wrong person who never got the land use change tax bill. So in order to get it out of the tax collector system, it has to be abated and then reissued.
Okay.
Okay.
So it's just reissued now under
who's
a different
the owner now?
Probably
name.
Dana.
I'm seeing it right now.
All right.
So, yeah.
So it's
just a cleanup, really.
So it's not Beverly, it's Dana.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep. That's fine. Same family.
Yeah.
It's just, you're just doing housework.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, just cleaning it to making it right.
Okay, we need a motion to approve that for the abatement, yep, we, so.
Yeah.
Motion for abatement approval?
Just need you to sign it in the new land use change tax sheet.
I'll make the motion to the abatement approval.
We have a motion for Ms. Queenan?
Signed on both sides.
We have a second.
No.
It's not in the board, it's, board is,
It's who we signed.
It's in the paperwork.
It's in the paperwork.
It's in the paperwork, that was.
But is Matt gonna be able to get the notes?
It's in the paperwork, yeah, 18,000.
Okay.
Yeah, he'll watch it.
So, it can be entered into the minutes as an abatement on map 16, lot 46-4.
Which is what we had, yeah. That was on there.
That's what we got, yes.
Alright. Perfect, thank you.
So, do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second from Mr. Gannon. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, motion carries 4-0-0.
This is your pile.
Then we have land use change tax, map 16, lot 46-4.
So that was the correction, so, yeah, so I.
So that's part of the last one?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I have to reissue now the locked.
Okay.
To the right person.
Alright.
No, no, he's just in Vegas, he didn't know.
Yeah, that's why you didn't get the bill.
That's why you didn't get the bill.
Yeah.
Do you want me to tell him to come down here with his checkbook?
He's not here now.
Oh, is he out west?
He's still out there.
Alright, up next.
Due to come back soon.
Town administrator and selectmen reports.
Okay, so this.
Oh, Kim.
So far.
10 words or less, can we do it?
Can, wait, no.
No.
Schedule is being set for the Penachuk consolidation case.
Yeah.
A new kind of.
Development?
Yes, thank you. That's the word. The city of Nashua has now filed to intervene.
Oh, good.
Who owns Penachuk?
Correct.
Okay. We figured that was coming, though. We kind of thought it would come at some point.
Thought it might, but it's an important development.
Yeah.
And then, because we just like this to get more complicated all the time, Penachuk has filed DW, case DW 24-029, which is for an increase in the QPAC of an additional 2.37% on top of the already approved earlier this month, 1.35%. This would raise the existing 6.31% to 8.67% as of September 2024.
Total increase, right?
Total increase. The total QPAC would be 8.67.
You say QPAC, I mean.
The qualified. Qualified charge for, basically it's the charge that you get.
Yeah.
Qualified capital project adjustment charge.
Okay.
So they figure out how much money the company has had to invest for quality projects, and they get to charge that back to the ratepayers. So on an average, average single residential bill, because not everybody pays this, some people pay more, but an average of 84.31 would go to about 91.62
per month. Oh, anyone that only pays $84 for water.
I pay 55.
You don't? No.
I do.
Well, I don't, because I have a well, but I mean,
my water bill is only $55 with Penachuk.
Can you share that here?
Harry doesn't use the water at home. I don't know.
Do you have a brook next to your house or
no,
a pond?
No, no.
Just two people in
there. Just tap off the neighbor's house.
Yeah, they got the water on timer. Hot water. You get 30 seconds of hot water.
So
That's on top of your regular service bill. This is.
That is. It is on top, and it just keeps going. So there's just no end to this. You know, they just got the. It was February 9th. They got the first increase of the 1.35%, and now the next one follows. So it is a demonstration of just, there's no end to this in sight. So
I really wish we could have got that warrant on the ballot this March.
Which one?
For the water.
Oh, that one, yeah. Yeah.
I know it'll come up next year, but I mean, I mean, that would have been perfect timing. anyone that might have been a naysayer. It's just, at some point, and again, I'm on a well, so I don't have a, you know, a dog in the fight, but, I mean, people complain about their water bills all the time. You hear taxes and you hear water bill. It's almost in unison.
I mean, yeah, geez, I think you
have to,
what color?
Be able to do something.
What color is the water supposed to be today?
Yeah. Light brown? Oh, it's tea.
So mine's light brown due to the fact when they dug the trench to go to my house with it, they cut my vein where my well comes through.
Oh, jeez.
And I had to put a filtration system on to get that out.
Nice. Last week we had a leadership meeting. Yeah. What we are planning, and we'd like to know if the board would be acceptable to this, is we'd like to hold or sponsor a volunteer award and recognition event in August. So kind of put on by the Board of Selectmen and the town staff to honor all of the volunteers, not only the volunteers that serve on our various boards and commissions, but the volunteers that assist them in cleanups. And what we would look to do, and we've been speaking with Mr. Jacques from the Litchfield Veterans, who would be willing to assist in some way. We'd look at having it over here at the new Litchfield Veterans, at a date to be set, and actually have a cookout. And so we'll reach out to some businesses that would be interested in making donations to the event. This would not come from taxpayer money or from town budget.
Sponsors.
We will raise sponsorships for the event.
Sounds like a great idea.
Yep. That's somebody in the back.
We have a lot of volunteers in this town, always have, and I think it's good to recognize them. I really do.
More to come, and we can work with some of the, you know, chairs from the various boards and commissions to see when they think it would be a best date, time, and things of that sort.
Just not the second week. I'm on vacation.
Okay, no second week.
There's so many types of volunteers in town, though. It's going to be big. I mean, religious, scouts.
Some
people
just
going to
say, "Leave me alone."
Helping the neighbor. That says a lot.
It's something
it's good, but it's going to be big.
Yeah, it's something that actually Mr. Jacques and I had talked about last year, and we just, there was so much on our plates. But I think it would be a very nice event, you know, to have something, some way that the town's giving back. We're not asking them to, you know, run an event to, honor themselves.
Yep.
So we can actually put some of our departments to heads to work, cooking and and grilling and things of that sort, and board members.
Good.
We did last Wednesday have the first special events proposed policy meeting with the residents. It went fairly well over at the fire station. We have a second meeting scheduled for this Wednesday. The thought is to get that policy back to you in some way in March.
Okay.
The department heads are working now on fee schedule changes. They're going to bring the proposal to me in March, and we hope to get it on your second meeting in March.
Okay.
This was a specific request of the budget committee. To have the fees looked at, whether it be the fees we're charging for building permits. Most of the town clerk fees are by statute, so we can't really change those, but we'll look at what fees we can and bring you a proposal.
Okay. Thank you.
This the next one is more of a
political
topic of conversation.
We
need some guidance from the board on signage, especially signage, during now, from now till March 12th.
Okay.
So down below, you will find I actually have given you the exact language that is sent out by the Secretary of State.
Yeah.
The important part being political advertising may not be placed on public property. It can be placed in a state right-of-way if the private property that abuts that state gives their permission. So now the question has come to, and I'll raise, the transfer station. State road, state right-of-way, does the town give permission for them to place their sign, not on town land, but in the town, in the state right-of-way, abutting the town land? That's a, that's been one that has been asked quite often. The other thing is, we've been specifically telling people that political communications, anything that's a sign that is talking about advocacy one way or another, must have a contact and an address on it.
Mm-hmm.
And we're finding signs around town that may just say the name of an organization, but there's no no address or contact information.
They have to come out. Oh, you got adjusted. That's always been the case.
It's always been the case.
Matt, Sharpie pen.
The bus signs, we had to put a name in.
Yeah, they can do a Sharpie pen.
That's what we did, Sharpie pen.
Yeah. Even a website, if they put a website, that counts.
Yep.
As long as there's some way for the person to go back and find out more information about them.
The other side of that, when you get into state right-of-ways, I know the state, all the years that I've enforced signs, they didn't really get involved with state roads very much, because especially when the political stuff starts coming up, they just let it go and eventually it disappears, okay? It's only for a certain amount of time. Mm-hmm. And I've asked about them going out to enforce it, and they said, we don't have the staff, okay? Which is common. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, they go around and take out signs. The highway departments are doing too many other things to patrol for signs on, like, Hillcrest Road, Route 3A. What I used to tell folks is, Hillcrest Road is a state road. As long as you keep it in the state right away, contact the state and go ahead and do it. It's not my job to enforce that. It's theirs. Anything in a town right away, it was my job to enforce. I tell folks to put it on their land, okay? And they do it like that. Now, of course, they get the ones that don't know where they live, okay? And you go out, and what I've done quietly was call them up and collect them and give them back to them to go put in the right spot, or call them up and they'll fix it the next day, mm-hmm. and bring it back, just something to follow up on. It gets done more efficiently. Now I'm making a big hip-roar about it, okay? And it just solves the problems. I was told today, and don't take this wrong, you people out there, that the Trump signs are used at the shooting gallery along with the other ones. That's all I got to say about that one.
So I think we're asking is,
sorry,
Litchfield has a sign ordinance, right?
But we don't.
And that ordinance is very clear.
Yep.
No signs except town and state highway direction, so stop signs, can be placed on Albuquerque. So the road agent has been going out and taking signs that are along Albuquerque. He has removed them. They are at the highway department, and if you're missing a sign that was on Albuquerque, you can stop by and pick them up. There's no destroying of signs. They are there.
What about people who live on Albuquerque? Can they do it in their own property?
On their own property. These have been on the town by the bike path,
yeah.
or
yeah,
the walking path.
Stuff.
they've been on the town land on Albuquerque, and that is prohibited by the Litchfield sign ordinance.
So this one's obviously a slippery slope, especially when it comes time for graduation, and it, the last couple of years since COVID, they've been lining this side of Albuquerque.
But that's not political.
No, but it's still a sign.
So would...
But this says political advertising may not be placed on public property.
So I think I understand the Litchfield sign ordinance 1504 does not say, it says no signs.
Says no signs?
That's right.
I don't see that here.
Right here. Here's the actual ordinance. It's ABC.
I think what we would ask is that if there were graduation signs to be placed, they come and they ask for the board's permission to place them.
Yep.
For however long they do that. I don't think they were there very long.
The roof mounted?
No, they weren't.
Because then the individuals picked them up and brought them to their houses.
Yeah, I think they're
going too far.
And then you get the grad, the kids that are graduating, they got those signs all over the place too, which is nice. Have we received a written complaint about these signs?
No, not written.
No, we haven't got a written complaint yet.
We, I had a, an email asking about the policy.
Yep.
On the signs, because this individual signs were picked up off Albuquerque. They were in the towns right away.
Somebody read the ordinance, did he bring it back on?
And the individual was told they're at the highway department and she can pick them up.
Okay. Those are ones that are the budget.
But here, this is what we're asking for the boards.
Cause the ones down on Route 3A, there's still signs that are there that were on the Hillcrest side, but they're on that side.
Yeah.
There's two missing and there's two that are still there and they're on Route 3A. They don't know which road's the state road, which is not. That's what's going on.
Hillcrest and Charles Bancroft Highway.
The intersection is what you're worried about, right?
In 102.
Are you worried about the intersection of Hillcrest and Albuquerque?
Hillcrest, Corning.
That's an intersection of two state roads.
102, right?
Hillcrest, 102, and Route 3A. That's it. Everything else is town.
Hillcrest, Corning, 102, and 3A.
Corning, no.
Corning's not?
Nope.
I thought it was a state road.
Replow it.
I know we plow it, but it's a state road.
I don't believe it's a state road, but it might be.
I think Kevin Brown told me.
You're right.
Yeah, because I lost a bet.
Lost a bet.
Yeah, a cup of coffee on that one.
Bobby, right. Yes, you're right.
It's a state road, but the town maintains it.
So next year,
same thing with Hillcrest.
Yeah, same with Hillcrest.
Go for elections again. There can't be any signs on the roads.
State road. Only on personal property.
Yes, but that's.
Town.
We've never enforced that before.
It's
never enforced it.
Never done that.
What about the intersection of Albuquerque and Hillcrest right out here? That's a popular place.
Hillcrest is a state road.
And so is Albuquerque's not yet.
Albuquerque.
On the Albuquerque.
Albuquerque's under the sign ordinance.
At the town road.
In somebody's yard, if given permission.
If,
yeah. You can put them in someone's private property.
Yeah.
The belief was the opposite. The belief was you could put a sign out there as long as it wasn't on private property that you didn't have permission on. It was in the state right away or the town's right away. But now this proves no. It cannot be in the town right away. It could be on private property with approval.
Or the state right away.
Or the state,
With the private.
The other strategy is on voting.
Yeah.
So the other strategy they did is on voting day, they'd take their signs and put them right near the high school. So as you're driving in.
So that was discussed. Discussed that with the town clerk. The day of elections, the school is not a school, it's a polling place. And it has commonly been practice.
Everywhere.
That signs are placed that day and picked up.
You got it.
At the next day. That I don't think we would be able to police that or should police that. If the board chooses not to have us follow the ordinance on Albuquerque, it's gonna be free game for signs all along the bike path. I'm not sure, and up in front of town hall, and I'm not sure that maybe that's why the ordinance was put into effect in the first place.
When was this ordinance put in? 2016. 2016? That's what I said there.
Which one?
It was amended March 8th, 1983, and March 1987, and March 2016.
Before you could do things. You could have done it
amended
before.
Amended many times. The first one was in 1981, so I don't know who was.
Most places people put signs are the end of Hillcrest.
Yep.
The intersection up here near the town hall, right?
Yeah, the busy.
End
busy
of Albuquerque.
The four-way in it, the four-way yeah. intersections.
And the way in near the Beaver Pond. That's about it.
And Albuquerque, when you come to Page, it's a great
station.
Place to put next to the stop sign.
And the transfer station was a big one.
The transfer station, I don't have a problem if somebody wants to put a sign up there.
State right of way.
Yep.
I would not allow political signs foot? On town property.
Is Hillcrest a 25-foot right of way, Kevin, or is that
50 footer?
That's 50 on that?
Yep, which the bounds are there too. You still
got it?
Yep.
Okay. So as long as they're within that.
Take 25 feet from the clear, from the center line of
either
road.
Side, yeah.
You decide, you
so
got
it. So it's 25-foot buffer, it's not a 50.
Right.
Okay.
The people at the cemetery are not going to complain.
So this is something that. Definitely have to, when someone comes in to sign up to run for a position,
you gotta
give them
the sign ordinance.
I still don't understand the part where it says you can't have one on your roof. That blows my mind. Somebody wants to put a sign on their roof. Why the hell can't they put a sign on their roof?
I think the difficult part that we're finding this election is they're not candidates.
No, we're talking about budgetary signs.
They're asking to support, different warrant articles.
Yep.
Need some direction from the board on what you want us to do.
I need to go step back a bit. Political signs, or are these people who are trying to run for office? Are they the same group?
No, an advocacy sign, a political advocacy sign, a sign asking you to vote a certain way.
Is a political sign.
Is a political sign.
Oh, I saw the and there. Political advertising and. Okay, political sign. So where are people going to put their signs? Friends' houses?
Front yard?
It's front yard.
In their friends' homes. In their friends' homes.
Side road, you meant. So, but I live on a main road, and I let people put on my property
you
signs.
You can.
Yeah. Prerogative. Yeah.
People, when they came to town, they asked to put one on my land. Is it sure?
It's the tough part is how do you get your name out there when you want to run for a position?
You got it. Maybe we write the sign ordinance.
Signs aren't cheap.
But then also, Kim's point is if we allow it for this, you could have anarchy with signs everywhere.
I know.
And right now, the sign, we don't allow signs on a lot of roads, so it's easier to remove them.
But there is still that little thing called freedom of speech. So, are we overreaching?
Well, we're not, because this has been in
I know it's
1981.
I'm saying we, but by
yes.
we, I mean the select.
We got some signs that are strapped at trees 12, 15 feet up in
yep.
the air.
Yep.
So obviously, the concern is that we can't turn a blind eye now, and somebody's already paying attention to this. So if there's signs put out there, and then not being picked up by the road agent, it's going to cause bigger problems.
But you've got to communicate that before you go out and do it. The road agent or the building inspector, he's a zoning guy, has to communicate that to the person, the reason why. And then go out. You just don't go out and take them. You give them fair warning.
Well, in all fairness,
seems
so...
Like
some of the signs that have been placed upon Albuquerque that have been removed per the ordinance have no telephone number and no contact information. He has no idea who to contact to have the conversation with.
That's a good point. Okay. The guy who's trying to get his trees done.
Well, if they're out there, then they're violating the. They're violating the policy anyways if they don't have the contact information. So I don't have a problem with removing those.
Right.
And if you have nobody to contact, then you don't. But, regular signs where people put their name and their address, maybe a phone number on it.
We used to put stickers on ours.
What do you think, Steve? Kim?
Is this, so our law is supposed to be more stringent than this, right? But we don't have a law at this level for
this
the state.
This is ours, isn't it?
No, the ABC one. I guess they only put A and B in the portal, but there's a C. But
Kim, do we have
matter.
To vote on this tonight?
So which one?
So,
well, we'll vote in a couple of weeks.
It's yeah, I know.
That's
we don't
the
meet,
problem.
We meet the night before the election.
Gotta get
that's
their signs
a hell,
out, right?
Hell of a time to come out with a...
Well, unfortunately, I think it's going to be an issue, and we need to know what you'd like us... Here's my... The Litchfield sign ordinance is a zoning ordinance.
Right.
So it was passed by the voters of this town. So I have a problem with with violating that without the voters saying...
That's understandable. But how was the ordinance written? I mean, the warrant written?
What was the premise?
Is it just... A warrant is very vague and says, do we update the signage? Or
I don't know if they, I don't know what
approved
it was
by
done.
The zoning board, or does it lay out exactly what?
Right.
Because that's a long warrant if they do that.
I'm going to throw another cog into the system. And that is, any zoning, it's a zoning issue, they have a right to appeal it to the zoning board of adjustment.
Yep.
Okay? Appeals. If they feel that it's not a violation, they state the reasons why. And they want to go to the board says it is a violation, then they come down.
Yep.
I think when it was written, I don't think they expected voting signs, but
yeah.
Well, they would have said whatever the state says.
Mm-hmm.
We never looked at the state stuff, I think we don't enforce that.
Yeah.
81, and a lot of the boards were disappointed as well, right? A lot of positions were appointed.
No, they were elected. I mean, selectmen were elected.
Yeah, there's three.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's three.
Zoning? Yeah.
Zoning
yeah,
was
were.
Appointed.
Was it appointed back then? Wasn't
zoning
elected?
Was appointed back then.
Okay.
Planning board was appointed to. Help me, you were there.
I have no idea. I thought a lot were appointed.
Yeah, back in that time period.
Yeah.
I know your father-in-law was a selectman. He ran. He got, to that.
Now a lot of these positions are elected, which kind of leads to more signs being put out there with your name.
Well, zoning board
what's
is not
elected? Budget board.
Budget and the selectmen. The rest is not elected.
School board.
Cemetery.
School board.
Trustees.
Trustees.
But they're not in a zoning issue. The planning board is appointed. The zoning board is appointed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the zoning issue all the way around.
Conservation's appointed.
Yep.
Library trustee is
elected.
Is elected. Budget committee.
What do you got? Library trustee.
Checklist supervisor.
Yeah.
Trustee of trust funds.
Okay.
And
but
a bunch of
especially
moderator
this.
Moderator is when his term's up. Yep.
Especially this election.
Yeah.
Other than the write-in for the selectmen and the write-in for the budget committee.
Yep.
Everyone else is. I wouldn't run out and buy signs for because the numbers are in your favor.
Still yours?
I was there.
I don't think those are, so far there has been no candidate signs.
Right.
The signs that are in question are these
don't
warrant article signs.
Yep.
Well,
so far.
What we should do is put that on our webpage.
That
section. We say that we received a complaint.
But they still need a sticker.
Concern.
An address or
okay, and what needs to be done for them to put up a sign, okay, and just let them show where the regulation is, and we'll go from there and see how far it goes to be appealed if it doesn't get appealed, okay.
So we're basically talking about the ones that say support education.
Basically, there's no name
so
on
far
that.
Those
are the ones that don't have. So I think if we contacted the school, that they would know who it is. I'm sure it's the LEA, but and just tell them they need to put a sticky on them.
That's all. Okay. Work with
them. If you want, I can reach out to a member of the school board. And
I know. I could talk to someone.
Yeah.
We got to work with them. We got to enforce it.
I think
we got to
tell
them what needs to be done.
So you're asking we need to. You're asking about a policy long term here. What we're going to do.
But I think
are we following the Litchfield ordinance and there's no signs along Albuquerque?
we have to say that they cannot put signs in the right of way, they can put it on people's land. And I don't care if we know if they get permission or not. That person doesn't get permission, that's a complaint, it goes from there.
And the landowner can remove it.
Yep.
It's on their property, they didn't give them permission, they can remove it.
Yes, you can, but.
If it's on your property.
Your land, you can dodge it.
Can't destroy it, you can remove it.
Yeah, you can't destroy it.
So what?
Do it three times.
Yeah.
Because I'm a cut the road, kind of a, that's your cut through people.
Yeah.
And the one you were just talking about was put on my property when I was down at my mailbox window, on my land, not in the right of way. And I went down, I said, I prefer not to have that sign on my property. And this particular person said, I have every right to put those signs out. I said, not on private property, you don't. So the person left, picked the sign up, I put it over in my garage, did not destroy it. I came back the next day, the sign was, there was another sign put on my property. Three times in a row. And I was just a little perturbed because I had mentioned I did not want it. I mean, you were asking for permission in a sense, but you're not getting it, and you're still doing it. So I don't know if it's the same person came back for three times or not.
Probably.
I was like.
Some people don't take no for an answer.
They don't take, I've gone around for years doing this, okay? especially when presidential elections or town elections when you've got, the smoke's a little higher and you get complaints and I get a complaint and I make it a written complaint and I go to the administrators of the board. This is what I'm going to do and I'm just following the rules. I contact them first. Tell them that you got signs that I'm getting complaints. Here they are. Go get them, or somebody else will, like I will, the next day. Okay, and I used to do that.
Is the sign ordinance easy to find on the website, or can you send me a link or something more?
It's in the ordinance.
Yeah. It's in the ordinance.
Yep. Do that and let people know what
planning
needs to be done.
Town Department's Planning Board, you'll see.
And with the state law to attach to it, you got the label.
So if you go to Albuquerque and Hillcrest and you go in the Hillcrest side in the, state
right of way. Yeah. That's like the only location.
So
where's the only
Hillcrest? Hillcrest, Charles Bancroft Highway. I mean, find a spot in there. It doesn't. If you want Albuquerque, I just have a.
It's a different ball game.
Did you read the actual article?
No, I did not.
The last part of the article, this came out of the warrant, the Florida guide that was in 2016, it says the temporary signs are also proposed to be allowed by right with no permit and displayed for 30 days. And this article mentioned the whole issue around free speech. That was what the change was in 2016. So I read that as.
But it's not in the ordinance.
For 30 days.
I'm just reading, that's why I was curious because.
Yeah.
I was trying to figure out if I didn't want to go on it too.
You're on the board then, right?
I did, right. So I'm to blame for everything around here. But
can we turn the cameras this way?
Yeah, right. But it's the last part kind of gets me that says they talk about occupation signs, real estate signs, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But it says clearly it was being done because of a change in law in 2015, versus town or somebody about free speech, and they said that everybody has the right to do it.
So then we should put it in the actual ordinance.
Yeah. As I was reading the ordinance going, this doesn't even match what happened in 2016, clearly. It doesn't look like that. I would just look at it and see if you agree. I don't know.
Let's hold back.
Yeah.
Do you have that?
We'll get it.
So I'll have to go back and look at the the warrant, but I mean.
Warrant in 2016?
Whatever was voted on is what should be in the ordinance that is displayed.
Okay. I agree with that.
Sometimes the ordinances don't get updated
quickly.
Apparently.
I've seen that.
I found it a few times now.
What I'm reading is from the board's guide,
signs on my
life. Yep. Not the actual warrant.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's what was described to folks to obviously help.
Yep.
All right. So let me go back and actually pull the warrant.
Okay. For 2016.
Can we agree that right now, if there are signs, they have to have the proper identification?
Absolutely.
Yes, I would 100% agree.
That's always
been
well known. I mean,
It's on the list that they give you when you sign up.
Yeah, I remember when I first ran, Terry gave me the paper. It was right there on it. You must identify you, the party.
Okay. Other than that, until we meet and we, again, which is going to be the 1st of March, the road agent's not going to pull signs.
Yes, correct.
Other than those that aren't properly identified.
Correct.
Okay.
And we can reach out to, see if you'll reach out, I will too.
Yeah.
A couple of school.
Need at least an email, a web address or an email or some kind of contact information.
There's got to be some identifying thing, yeah.
Right.
And whether or not you agree with a particular article or whatever, they still should have the right to post.
You need a temporary permit, or you just...
And whether they're in the right of way, that's one thing, but we're not going to have signage along Town Hall and...
Not out here, no.
And, right, so town land.
Yes, the police station, fire station, Town Hall.
And that's by the states.
Yes, there shouldn't be anything.
I haven't seen anybody do that, have you?
They put signs up before, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, especially when we were in the old Town Hall.
It was a town, they tried to do it along the crest and out the front.
Yeah, right out in front. Yep.
Yeah.
They still do the intersection out here, but not much.
You can do the intersection, just not out in front of the buildings.
I mean, that's in the Secretary of State's law on may not be placed on public property except the right of way. So I think we stay with that.
Yep, yep.
Otherwise, you know, Recreation Commission comes and I got a baseball field full of signs.
Yep.
So no permits required for the 30-day temp, you just can do it for 30 days.
Yep.
That's how I'll read, but I'm obviously going to refer to Kim.
I don't know if...
Yeah, when you find that, you'll send it out to us.
I will send it out.
It was over, it was 8 years ago.
Good memory.
There's another thing, the reason why these signs come up. There was a big, when snow blowers, plowing and stuff like that, or tree removal.
Yep.
Yeah, this is the current, that's the ordinance.
That's the current one?
That's the current one, but maybe it wasn't updated correctly. Definitely worth checking out.
I have seen that quite a bit.
What's that?
The zoning ordinance doesn't get updated. I mean, it was approved, but it was never...
Never updated.
Never updated.
It did that for a reason, so we don't have to deal with it. Iggy, what? Kim?
Not often, but it does happen.
You want it?
I didn't know Bob wanted it.
You want this one?
Always.
All right, so I'll move on to the next so that we can...
I'm at a different...
Go into the work session.
The town report is coming along. We're expecting the schools section on Wednesday, and hopefully we can get it out. The voter guide is being mailed on Thursday.
Okay.
So the post office has 48 hours, so people should expect it Saturday or at least very latest Monday.
So you don't have the school stuff yet?
For the town report.
For the town report, we don't have the school yet.
The annual report, no.
Know why that is?
I believe they're working on it. It's not near deadline.
Not at the top priority right now.
So, I have a request.
A request?
Because there's a lot of conversation about the impact fees.
Yep.
So I would like to ask the board if I can request for council and the planning chair and the NRPC representative to meet with this board so that we can have a total conversation.
Makes sense.
That would be a meeting with council and would not be an open meeting.
Are they talking about the number? Are they talking about adjusting it? Or are they talking about what to do with it?
The board had a lot of questions at the last meeting. I think that leads to even more questions. And I think we need a legal opinion. And I think that the board and the planning board and NRPC all need to be together with council. So I would like to schedule a special meeting with council to get this over and done with.
That'd be a private meeting behind closed doors?
It would be a meeting with council, a non-meeting. Yeah.
I did speak with Jay Mancur, and he did give me input on that. He believes we were right. GMS only.
I concur, but I won't go there.
So we'll have to see legally if that's different. He agrees that it should be on the SIP, and the money goes collected for that item on the SIP. But let's see.
Yes.
This was going to come to a head anyway, because we still about what qualifies to be an impact fee or not, but he can explain it.
And I think
that's good.
There's a lot of legal counsel comes back to the board, but it would be helpful if Jay Mancara and Michael Cordo were also there.
Absolutely. And they're both SIP too, right?
Yep.
Right.
I agree. Let's do that.
Do it.
Okay, perfect. I will reach out to counsel.
Okay.
You know, other than that, there's just
Water guy, good to go.
You got any more?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we have a couple more things.
Nope, just non-public.
Oh, what was that?
We need
it's my water.
There goes the vodka.
Oh, I filled this with water, right?
Go get the top.
Thanks, Kevin.
Kim, you had brought up two things earlier.
Yeah.
The new business, we should
Can I just go back to Kim, though?
Yep.
The revised, just for myself, revised farmer's market.
Yep.
It just was revised on 1/22/24.
Yep.
Yep.
Could we go over that?
We did not.
Was
it just
no,
something
I
quick?
I sent it to you, and then it just asked for the board to
take a look. I just didn't know
whether
what
they wanted to bring it up. That was the changes in the health
department.
You
right.
know, the fact that you don't need a inspection.
Thanks, Kev.
Thank you.
So yeah, I brought up two more that I think I gave them to you.
Yeah.
Over there.
Credit card,
quick
chief,
and then the deputy,
the forest warden.
Thank you.
Yeah.
The wardens for the deputy.
Yeah, for the forest wardens. Yep.
Is that it there? Is that the piece of paper? I gave you the names.
The credit card for the chief was Doug. I mean,
he's a good waiter.
We have to grab his credit card.
Yep.
And
yeah, signed up for that, so
and the fire warden.
The fire wardens.
Warden,
I gave you the list.
Yep. No, I don't think you gave me the list. But you know, it could be in there. These
need those.
Yes.
Need that one.
He just needs
that one. Okay.
He just needed to sign.
I think is that the two?
You're
one and two
voted
at the top.
Oh, this here.
On
the
that
consent?
You need a vote
for the consent agenda. Okay.
Kevin's PO here.
So,
yeah.
Just put it over here. We already voted to add him to the consent agenda.
You did.
Early. Okay. So
you did.
So we have first on the consent agenda is credit card approval from the town to issue a credit card to Chief Dan Jones, police chief.
So moved.
So moved.
I'll second it.
We have a motion from Mr. Ginn, a second from Mr. Lynch. My question would be, does it follow the same limits as the old chief's credit cards? Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. And I'm good with it. Kim, you got any questions on that? Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Karen will keep track of them.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Karen will.
Karen
will. All right. Second, we have the 2025 reappointment to District 21 Forest Fire Warden. The following individuals: Craig Cartier, Deputy Warden; Ryan DeFrenza, Deputy Warden; Ed Glancy, Deputy Warden; Paul Kelly, Deputy Warden; Brian Kimball, Deputy Warden; Jeff Newell, Deputy Warden; and Doug Nickel, Warden. We need a motion to approve.
So moved.
We have a motion from Mr. Gannon.
Second.
Second from Ms. Queen, and all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 400.
And they've had that many deputy wardens in my lifetime.
Right.
Did you sign
it? Do we have anything we have selectmen reports. Is there a non-public tonight?
Yeah.
Okay. So selectmen reports. Kim, I'm going to let you go first.
Pass
all
this
right
on down.
Yep. Then you can sign that and send it to Steve.
Okay, I'll do that in a sec.
I can't talk about my
planning board. We conditionally approved the Tallarico development. We were there until 11 o'clock at night.
Oof.
Last Tuesday. So I do work well with Reggie.
Yep.
Just letting you know. Impact fees. I spoke with Jay Mancara during the meeting. It's public information. It was correct. It goes to GMS only for items collected for GMS, is what he said. So let's have the meeting.
I remember that being listed on the schedule back in the day.
Yeah, he said that maybe it fell flat for a few years. Nobody looked at the SIP, and the money was being collected, and, you know, so. Okay.
John?
SIP.
Getting a message the BOS feed is down?
Yeah, YouTube went down, so we're still recording to channel 16 and going to post.
It'd be wireless.
Channel 16?
Channel 16 on cable.
The old way. Do you have a satellite channel?
No.
I have the antenna on my roof still.
It's called YouTube?
We'll repost it. As soon as I get home, I'll repost it.
Okay, cool. Thank you for that.
All right, the SIP meets after the town vote.
Yeah.
I have March 12th. Am I wrong on the town vote? 7 to 7?
It's the 13th, actually. It's the second Tuesday.
Does that go Sunday? Sunday's
the first
day.
It's the 12th.
It's the 12th.
It's the 12th?
Is it the 12th?
Okay.
That calendar's
February. Oh, that's
February?
Okay.
That's
the 29th.
So we'll meet after the 12th.
We can go to this one over here, but it says February.
Desperately needed to get other items on the list. All right. Economic development. Oh, by the way, the planning board meets March 5th, 7 p.m. at the town hall. All right. Economic development. We met. We're going to be meeting March 27th. Wait a minute. Yeah. At 6:30 p.m. next in another month. We completed the survey for the town. You have seen it in your portal. Connie Jackson is now a voting member.
Mm.
All right, Energy Committee. We had completed the community power objective that we met, so it's going to the ballot. We meet this week, Thursday, February 29th, 6 p.m. All right, we'll let the voters decide on that. All right, NRPC. What did we do there? I think I said something else for the Energy Committee.
Mm-hmm.
Just so you know, when I went to the NRPC meeting this week, we kind of had a full commissioner meeting quarterly in February because we had to do some voting early. Three other towns are putting this on their ballot as well. So we're not the only town in our area. As far as NRPC, we did complete our draft statement of strategy, waiting for that full commissioner meeting to approve it. What we did vote on in February was the TIP. The Transportation Improvement Program had amendments done to it for 2023 to 2026. So far, Corning Road is still on the plan. These were just new things added into it. And by law, we had to do the Metropolitan Transportation Plan. We had votes on that as well for 2023 to 2050. So we're looking out ahead for the highway group. NRPC Executive Committee, we're reviewing the director, his yearly review. And obviously, the financials we always keep an eye on. Those are my reports.
Good. Up next, Heritage, Mr. Gannon.
Unfortunately, I was not able to attend the last meeting due to a work obligation.
Mm-hmm.
They are changing the date to Thursdays, I believe, and possibly 6 p.m., but they still got to work with John and Kim to make sure the room's free and move things around.
Okay.
I think it's done. Yeah, I think it's done.
You think it's done? Perfect. That's it. All right, Mr. Lynch.
Conservation Commission, we had a meeting behind closed doors, can't say no more.
Okay. emergency management, facilities, anything on that?
I couldn't make it to that meeting. Okay. I was at a medical issue.
Very good. Thank you. Budget does not meet until after the election. We're kind of on a little break right now. So tune in after the election. Okay.
Fun begins.
All right. So
no Mr. Webber, so no recreation.
And no rec tonight, yep. All right. And then the tabled policies, we still have the special events permit for the 4th of July and the Christmas parade. What you said earlier, that they're working on that together.
Mm-hmm.
They are working
so
on that.
We'll stay updated on that just so everyone's in the loop at home.
I can give you an update on recreation. The Recreation Commission came forward and had a conversation with me about fees. Should have been on tonight's agenda, my error. But Steve isn't here, so it
yep.
just happened to work out well.
Yep.
They will be on, just my luck.
The next one.
They will be on your next agenda on the 11th.
You know, nobody yes. would have known if you didn't say.
Exactly.
Totally transparent. You can see right through me.
Yeah.
Somebody would have known. The ones watching.
Yeah.
Well, they're not watching now, but later they will be.
Well, I felt horrible on Saturday when I realized.
So the conspiracy theorist in me says that this was coordinated.
No.
Yeah, but I'm
the feed
like,
goes down and.
All I know this morning, somebody couldn't start a car, is all I heard.
Yeah. A remote starter.
You had to do it the old fashioned way with the key?
Yeah, take the key out of the fob. I didn't even know there was a key in the fob.
Don't worry, my wife will give you that.
Oh, yeah, my husband's like, take the key out of the fob. What are you talking about?
Been great
about?
In the old crank days. Trying to do it with a fob. Crank, will you? All right.
Not a mechanical bone in my body.
My tractor is still the same way, Bob.
Yep. Yep. I had one.
Yep.
I had one. All those chambers.
Oh.
Let's see. All right. So that's it for the live portion of the program. Up next, we have non-public under 91 RSA 91-A semicolon 3 comma 2A. Dismissal, promotion, compensation of any public employee or disciplining of such employee or the investigation of any charges against him unless the employee affected one has a right to a meeting and two requests that the meeting be open, in which case the request shall be granted. And under RSA 91-A semicolon 3-2 D in parentheses, consideration of the acquisition, sale, lease of real or personal property, which if discussed in public, would likely benefit a party or parties whose interests are adverse to those of the general community. That being said, do we have a motion going to non-public?
So moved.
Second. Motion from Mr. Gannon and a second from Mr. Lynch. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 400. We are now going into non-public at 8:49 p.m. Everyone have a wonderful night, and we will
pick up your wet spot
here on the night before election.